In this lecture, we're going to look at unsupervised learning. All the machine learning techniques that we've looked at thus far have essentially been supervised learning techniques. There are a number of different unsupervised learning algorithms, and we're going to look at the most popular one, which is the k-means algorithm. So we'll work through the algorithm, and then we'll apply the algorithm to an example to see how it works. So one of the main differences between supervised learning and unsupervised learning is that the data you have, the data set, the data instances in the data set, these do not contain labels. So for example, when we looked at the fruit example in the previous scenarios with different machine learning techniques, we had different attributes representing the fruit, like the thickness of the skin, the shape of the fruit, the color of the fruit. And then based on that, we had a label which said whether it was a grapefruit or a lemon or an apple. So in the case of unsupervised learning, we don't have those labels. We basically just have attribute values. If we're doing unsupervised learning, then generally we use clustering algorithms to create different classes or groups or clusters. If we're doing supervised learning, then we use classification algorithms. And as you've seen from the course, that there are different techniques you can use for classification. You can use neural networks, you can use genetic programming, you can use decision trees, etc. You can use k-nearest neighbor. So what we're going to look at now is a similar thing for unsupervised learning, and we're looking at clustering algorithms. There are a number of different clustering algorithms, and each of them, as you'll see, incorporate different measures to work out the distance between clusters, etc. The algorithm that we're going to focus on is the k-means algorithm. The k represents the number of clusters, and this value is usually randomly selected, or you could use certain techniques, and one of the techniques is the elbow technique, which we're going to look at just now. Essentially, k-means is used for numerical data, so the values of your attributes should be numerical. If you have attributes that are not numerical, then you can convert them to numerical values, or alternatively, you can look at different versions of k-means that will work on data, such as mixed data. So like I said, the value of k, what does it represent? It represents the number of clusters that you initially want and that you're going to actually have. That value, the most appropriate value to use, is problem dependent. You can actually estimate this value. You can't find an optimal value for k, but you can estimate using different techniques. And one of the most popular techniques is something called the elbow method. We're not going to go through the elbow method. I'm going to leave that as a tutorial for you to work through. For purposes of the lecture, we're basically just going to randomly choose a value for k. So if we look at the overall algorithm, you basically have a set of attributes. So D there represents your data set. Each D1 represents a particular attribute in or a particular data instance, and that data instance will then have values for its different attributes. So you'll have D11 through to D1M, where M is the number of attributes. So the first thing we do is we determine what K should be. And like I said, we can randomly choose this value, but a better way of doing that is using the elbow method to actually determine what this value is. The elbow method basically graphs the data points that you have to estimate this value. Once you have a value for K, you know how many clusters you have. And then based on those clusters, you've got to actually choose a centroid for each cluster. Now that centroid comes from the set D. So D has data instances D1 to Dn, and you randomly choose one of those data instances to be the centroid of each cluster. You don't want to choose the same centroid for the two clusters, because then it doesn't make sense to have two clusters of the same centroid. So when you're choosing, you need to make sure it's a different centroid each time. You don't choose the same DI. So for example, if you randomly chose K to be 2, then you'd randomly choose two data instances from D to be the cluster, to be the centroid of those clusters. So this overall wild algorithm, that's the algorithm that basically performs the k-means algorithm. That's the loop that performs the k-means algorithm. So as you can see, this loop will stop when the algorithm has converged. Now, what do we mean by convergence in terms of k-means? We've looked at different types of convergence when we looked at neural networks, but in terms of k-means, it's something different. Basically, what happens on each iteration of the k-means algorithm, you go through each data instance, you find how close it is to the centroid of each cluster, and then you add it to the cluster. Once that happens, you then update the centroid values, and you'll see those are basically the average of all the data instances for that attribute value in the cluster. And then you go through the whole loop again, and you check to see whether how far your data instances are from the new updated centroid values. And you may find that a data instance DI that belongs to one cluster is actually closer to a centroid of another cluster. And in that case, that data instance is moved to that cluster. So you're constantly updating your centroid values based on how your clusters change. And then when the centroid values are updated, that may result in data instances moving between clusters. So we have convergence if for an entire iteration of the while loop, there's been no movement of data instances between clusters, then your k-means algorithm has converged. So if we look at the first for loop, this for loop is basically working through each DI in your set D, and the main aim of this loop is to decide which cluster that DI belongs to. The second loop is then working through the clusters to work out the Euclidean distance between the centroid attribute values and attribute values in the DI. So if you remember, the Euclidean distance is basically we take the square root of the difference between each DII and each KII, for example, or we should say DI, we should use another letter, DIR and KIR. So attribute 1's value in DI, subtract attribute 1's value in KI, and we in KJ, and we take the square of that difference, and we do that for each dimension or each attribute value in the vectors, and we sum all of that and we take a square root. So that's basically your Euclidean distance. So once we work out the Euclidean distance, then we can decide for each DI which was the smallest Euclidean distance and to which cluster was that smallest distance, and then we add DI to that cluster. So once we've done that, we should be at a point where we have our first set of clusters if we're on the first iteration. The next thing we now want to do is to update the centroid values. So the centroid values are always updated when clusters are either formed or there's a change in the composition of the clusters. So the outer loop there is going to actually iterate through each of the clusters, and the inner loop is iterating through the attributes of the data instances in the cluster. So the attribute values in D1 through to Dn, so D11 to D1m. And basically what's happening is to calculate the new centroid values, you're basically taking the average of the values of all the data instances in the cluster for that attribute. And that is how you calculate the new centroid or the updated centroid. And then of course the last step is then to update your centroid based on that. We're now going to look at an example to see how you can apply the k-means. It's a very simple example. In real life, your examples are a lot more complicated than this, but the idea is for you to understand how the algorithm works. So this is an example of data instances. So suppose these are the data instances in your training set. You've got different entities. We don't know what these entities are. So they could be flowers, they could be cars, they could be anything. And there are five entities, so there are five data instances. There are two attributes for each entity. So for example, if it's a flower, it may be the flower color and the petal shape. And notice our values are numerical. So if you're doing a flower color, maybe you had an integer to represent each color, and the shape simply an integer to represent each shape. And those are now your two attributes. So each data instance has dimension 2, and that represents each of the attribute values for that data instance. So if you remember our algorithm, the first step that we've got to do is we've got to randomly choose k. So in this case, we randomly choose k to be 2. And then we randomly choose two centroids, one for cluster 1 and one for cluster 2. So in this case, we randomly choose 2 to be the entity for cluster 1. So that's the centroid for cluster 1. And we randomly choose 4 to be the centroid for cluster 2. So those are both the centroids. Once we've got the centroids, we now have to work out the Euclidean distance for the remaining entities from those centroids. and the one in which there's a smaller distance, it will then go into that cluster. So the remaining entities are 1, 3, and 5, and we've got to work out how far those vectors are from the vectors for 2 and the vectors for 4. So if you look at the Euclidean distance, if you look at entity 1, so cluster 1, the centroid was entity 2, and entity 1 has a value, a Euclidean distance of 1.11 from the centroid of cluster 1, and Euclidean distance of 5 from cluster 2, which was entity 4 in our data set. And then if we look at 3, it has an Euclidean distance of 1.8 from the centroid of cluster 1 and 2.25 from the centroid of cluster 2. And then lastly, entity 5 has an Euclidean distance of 4.03 from the centroid of cluster 1 and 1.8 from cluster 2. So if we look at the remaining three entities that are not centroids, you can see 1 and 3 are closer to centroid 2, entity 2, and so those will go into cluster 1. And the last entity, entity 5, has a smaller Euclidean distance to the centroid of cluster 2, which was entity 4. So then we have entities 4 and 5 in cluster 2. So if we now look at the different clusters, our first cluster has entity 1, 2, and 3, and 2 was the centroid for cluster 1 when we started off. And then the second cluster has entity 4 and 5, and 4 was the centroid when we started off. Now, if we look at how we'd update our centroid values, for each attribute we calculate the average of the attribute values in that cluster. So if we look at cluster 1, the way we calculate the new centroid value or the updated centroid value for attribute 1 is we take the average of all those values, 1, 1.5, and 3, and we average that by 3. Similarly, for attribute 2, we take the average of those three values, 1, 2, and 4, and we divide that by 3 because there are three values, and then we get 2.5. Similarly, in the same way, we update the attribute values for cluster 2, for the centroid values for attribute 1 and attribute 2. So now that we've calculated our new centroid values, we've got to check whether each of the entities or each of the data instances belong to the right cluster. So what we've got to do is we've got to recalculate the Euclidean distance, and we're now looking at taking the Euclidean distance not from entity 2 in cluster 1, but for the updated average values, and similarly not from entity 4 in cluster 2, but for the updated centroid values, which are the averages. So if we now look at the updated values, you can see that cluster 1, the closest values for each of the entities is still the centroid in cluster 1. And similarly for cluster 2, the closest or the smallest Euclidean distance is to the centroid in cluster 2. So there's no movement between clusters. And because there's no movement between clusters, we've had for a complete iteration, we've had no change in your clusters, which means our algorithm has converged. So the k-means algorithm will stop there, and we've got two clusters. We've got one cluster with three entities and a second cluster with two entities. Now, we'd have to then go and look at the clusters and look at the attribute values to get an idea of what was put in each cluster. You may find that everything that was put in cluster one represents rows, and if these were attributes that had to deal with flowers, and everything that's put in cluster two may be a lily or something like that. So those clusters will actually define a class or a category, the clusters that the k-means divides the data into. And you can actually look at the attributes in the data to get an idea of what the cluster represents. So that is basically the k-means algorithm. It's a very simple algorithm, but a very powerful algorithm. You'll see it can be used in quite complicated problem domains to get good results. And this basically brings us to the end of unsupervised learning and looking at different machine learning techniques. In Tuesday's lecture, we're going back to look at evolutionary computation, and we're finishing the last section on that, which is particle swarm optimization and ant colonization. So we'll start off by looking at ant colonization during Tuesday's lecture, and in Wednesday's lecture, we'll look at PSO. So I'm going to stop there for today's lecture.